Jesus is praying. Peter is asleep. Judas is betraying. But Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Pilate's struggling. The council is conspiring. The crowd is vilifying. They don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary's crying. Peter is denying. But they don't know that Sundays are coming. It's Friday. The Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in scar. They crown him with thorns. But they don't know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary. His blood dripping. His body stumbling. And his spirit's burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The world's winning. People are sinning, and evil's grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nailed my Savior's hands to the cross. They nailed my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raised him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something, Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't know it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. He's hanging on the cross, feeling forsaken by his Father. Left alone and dying. Can nobody save him? Oh, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, the earth trembles, the sky grows dark, my king yields his spirit. It's Friday, hope is lost, death has won. Sin has conquered, and Satan's just a laughing. It's Friday. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard, and a rock is rolled into place. But it's Friday. It is only Friday. Sunday is a coming. Thank you.
cry out, "Jesus." In our desperation, in our longing, we lift our eyes to the heavens. The Savior that was promised reached down to us, becoming flesh. At his entrance, they laid palms at his feet, as today, in his presence, we fall to our knees. We cry out to him hanging on the cross, the righteous one whose blood broke the curse. With an act of love that saved our souls, overflowing redemption making us whole. No nail to the bones could hold him. No crown of thorns could shame him, because he is the one. No tomb could contain him. Death could not stop him. He conquered the grave and rose from death victorious. We cry out, "Jesus, Jesus, Jesus, you are the resurrection and the life. In you all things come alive." We will forever declare the mighty power of your name. We cry out with everything we have. We need you, Savior, and nothing else, because in you we are saved by grace. Your glory will shine upon the world, and every tongue will cry out, "Jesus is the Lord."
It's Friday. Jesus is praying. Peter is asleep. Judas is betraying. But Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Pilate's struggling. The council is conspiring. The crowd is vilifying. They don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary's crying. Peter is denying. But they don't know that Sundays are coming. It's Friday. The Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in scar. They crown him with thorns. But they don't know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary. His blood dripping. His body stumbling. And his spirit's burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The world's winning. People are sinning. And evil's grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nailed my Savior's hands to the cross. They nailed my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raised him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't know it's only Friday. Sunday, my king yields his spirit. It's Friday. Hope is lost. Death has won, sin has conquered, and Satan's just a laugh. It's Friday. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard, and a rock is rolled into place. But it's Friday. It is only Friday. Sunday is a coming.
Cry out, Jesus. In our desperation, in our longing, we lift our eyes to the heavens. The Savior that was promised reached down to us, becoming flesh. At his entrance, they laid palms at his feet, as today, in his presence, we fall to our knees. we cry out to him hanging on the cross, the righteous one whose blood broke the curse. With an act of love that saved our souls, overflowing redemption making us whole. No nail to the bones could hold him. No crown of thorns could shame him, because he is the one. No tomb could contain him. Death could not stop him. He conquered the grave and rose from death victorious. We cry out, Jesus, 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 you are the resurrection and the life. In you all things come alive. We will forever declare the mighty power of your name. We cry out with everything we have. We need you, Savior, and nothing else, because in you we are saved by grace. Your glory will shine upon the world, and every tongue will cry out, Jesus is the Lord.
It's Friday. Jesus is praying. Peter is asleep. Judas is betraying. But Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Pilate's struggling. The council is conspiring. The crowd is vilifying. They don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary's crying. Peter is denying. But they don't know that Sundays are coming. It's Friday. The Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in scar. They crown him with thorns. But they don't know that Sunday's come. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary. His blood dripping, his body stumbling, and his spirit's burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The world's winning. People are sinning. And evil's grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nailed my Savior's hands to the cross. They nailed my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raised him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't know it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. He's hanging on the cross.
I'm going to call on Reverend Chaplain Vassy Maskell to do the invocation for us. A blessed good morning to one and all. We give God the thanks and we give God the praise this morning. So let's look to the God of our Father in prayer. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, this morning, on this day, Lord, we come before you, Lord. We come before you with hearts of gratitude, Lord, and thankfulness, Heavenly Father, because, Lord, you have woke us up this morning, dear God, and you have woke us up in our rightful mind, Heavenly Father, and it's nothing, Lord, that we have done, but through your grace, Lord, through your mercy, dear God, through your love for us, dear Heavenly Father, that you have brought us again into your sanctuary, dear God, another year, Heavenly Father. We give you the thanks and we give you the honor, dear God. Lord, we remember the obstinate sacrifice, dear God, that you have given, Lord, for our life, Heavenly Father. You was rejected, dear God. You were suppressed, dear God. You, Heavenly Father, was affected, dear God. But yet you, God, was prepared, Lord, to take the life, Lord, to take the womb, Lord, for our righteousness, dear God, for our freedom, dear God, that we will have eternal life, Heavenly Father. Lord, we thank you right now. We ask you your presence right now, Lord, to surround each and every one of us this morning. We welcome you. Our hearts are open, dear God, for your presence right now, dear Heavenly Father. As we reflect, dear God, on the profound sacrifice, dear God, Lord, I ask that you bind us together, Lord. Bind us together, Lord, in love. Bind us together, Lord, in mercy. Heavenly Father, and bind us in unity, dear God, as one under one roof this morning, dear God. As your servant, dear God, we cry out to you this morning, Lord. Have mercy, dear God, on us, Lord. We give you our all this morning, dear God, this morning. Father, Lord, I invite your spirit, Lord, this morning into this service, dear God. Take residence, dear God. Take residence, Heavenly Father, I ask you this morning. Lord, because there is none other, Lord, like you this morning. Lord, we can't do nothing, Lord, without you this morning. Lord, I ask you, Lord, to take away self there, Lord. Lord, I ask you this morning, Lord, that you will give us the Holy Spirit this morning. Lord, as we intervene, Lord, as we come into your presence, dear Lord, this morning, dear God. Lord, I ask that you restore us. Lord, I ask that you inspire us. Lord, I ask that your presence, dear God, may take root in our heart. Lord, I ask that our prayers, dear God, and the messages, dear God, of your anointed servant, dear God, be sweet, innocent, dear Heavenly Father, in the heaven above this morning, Lord, as it take root in our hearts. May our hearts, Lord, be receptive to hear. May our voice, Lord, may our ears, Lord, be open, Lord, to your word this morning, dear God. Because we give you all. We give you all. We turn ourselves unto you this morning. Heavenly Father, touch us, Lord. Touch us, Lord, from the altar right down to the door, dear God. Lord, and as we go through this day, Lord, may you dwell with us. May we never leave this building the way we come in this morning. We give you thanks and we give you praise that is due unto you this morning, dear God. We thank you from the rising of the sun to the going down thereof, Lord. We thank you. We worship you. We glorify you this morning, Heavenly Father. Touch us, dear Lord. Touch us, Heavenly Father. We give you thanks and we give you praise in the mighty name of Jesus. let your children say amen and amen. Glory be to God.
Now, Licentiate Glenda Lewis, the assistant pastor of Peel BME Church, is coming to read the word.
Good afternoon. The scripture reading is from Isaiah chapter 53, reading from verse 1 to 12. Please stand for the reading of the word. Isaiah chapter 53. 1 to 12. Let's hear the reading of the word of God. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is this arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He has no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid as if were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death. Because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteousness servant justify many, for he shall bear his iniquity. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sins of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
I want to welcome each and everyone to another Good Friday service. And I'm going to present to you the speaker of this Good Friday service. Amen? The first word will be Reverend Javarus Smith, Emmanuel Temple, and it is taken from Luke 23:34. And the second word is Luke 23:43, Reverend Maurice Hicks, Christ Church BME. The third word is John 19:26-27. Reverend Patrick Reed, Cornerstone Baptist Tabernacle. The fourth word, Matthew 27:46. Reverend Dr. Wendell Gibbs, First Baptist Church. The fifth word, John 19:28. Reverend Arthur Martin, East York BME Church. And the sixth word is John 19:30, Pastor Jonathan Reed, Cornerstone Baptist Church. I'm so proud to see this. And the seventh word is your humble servant, Reverend Julia Moses, Peel BME Church. Amen? Amen? So these will be the speaker for the day. And I'm asking God's anointing to continue to fall on you all. Amen? Amen? So we're now going to have the first word. Amen? Reverend Javarus Smith. Yeah, give him a clap.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Good morning. Good afternoon. It is now the noonday hour. But we're going to continue to bless God and thank God for waking us up this morning and starting us on our way. Do I have any witnesses in the house this afternoon that is glad that God woke you up this morning and started you on your way, clothed you in your right frame of mind? Amen. It is a privilege to be here once again before you on this wonderful day to bring a word of encouragement, a word that will edify the people, but most importantly, glorify God. Amen? Amen. Amen. As is the tradition, I guess I'm going to have to be my choir today. And so I pray God's strength and pray your strength also. There we go. Amen. The blood that Jesus, he shed
for me. Way back on Calvary, oh, the blood that gives me strength from day. Gives me strength from day, Lord, today it will never lose its power. How many know this part? I know.
Now let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, for you are my strength and you are my redeemer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. The Bible says in Luke chapter 23, verse 34, and Jesus prayed, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they divided his garments and distributed them by casting lots for them. I would like to tag this text this afternoon, to forgive or not to forgive. My beloved brothers and sisters, first let me say once again, good afternoon. As we gather here in the house of the Lord, a place where broken hearts are mended, where weary souls are rejuvenated, and the spirit of forgiveness flows like a mighty river. Today, on this day where we celebrate where we celebrate our Lord and Savior giving up his life that you and I may have life, not only eternally, but have life abundantly. I want you to come with me and let me carry you on a journey and into a passage that will challenge the very core of your Christian walk, your Christian journey. We are going to deal with a subject that is as delicate as it is powerful, a subject that is as personal as it is universal, the art and the act of forgiveness, which is illuminated by the words of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as he hung bleeding, as he hung bruised upon an old rugged cross on a hill called Golgotha. In Luke chapter 23, verse 34, we hear the heart of God speaking through the lips of Jesus. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. If there was ever a time for righteous indignation, if there was ever a time for justified anger, yes, he had the right to be mad. If there was ever a time for him to act out in revenge, if there was ever a time because he had the power to make it go away just like that, if there was ever a time for him to speak a word over us and just get rid of us, it was then. But no, that is not what he did. And so I want you to understand what the great act of forgiveness that happened on Calvary's cross, because he didn't have to forgive us, but he did. He didn't have to offer us grace, but he did. And I don't know who's sitting here under the sound of my voice this morning, this afternoon, but when you look back over your life and you think things over and you think about the many times that he should have taken you out when you were doing stuff that was not pleasing unto him, when he should have taken you out when you were acting like you didn't have your right frame of mind, but because of his grace and his mercy, you are sitting here today. He's sitting here today because he chose forgiveness. He chose grace. And so with the help of the Holy Spirit and the real preacher Jesus Christ, because I only got about 9 minutes left, I want to unpack this profound moment in biblical history and what it means for you and I today by briefly illuminating these 3 points that will help us in this journey that we call Christendom. And the first is this: we have to understand the power of forgiveness. Yes, first we must recognize the power of forgiveness. Forgiveness is just not a simple act of saying, I forgive you. It is an expression of divine strength. When Jesus petitioned the Father for forgiveness on behalf of his accusers, he demonstrated an otherworldly power that defies human understanding, because you and I know how we get sometimes. We say we forgive, but we don't really forgive. Forgiveness is the power to break the chains of bitterness. Some of us are still walking around with bitterness, not forgiving people, and the person has either died, moved on, and you still caught up in your unforgiveness, and they don't even understand what's going on with you because they're no longer here, but you have decided you're going to keep yourself wrapped up, tied up, tangled up in unforgiveness, and then come to church on Sunday morning and sing, I'm wrapped up, tied up, tangled up with Jesus. The devil is a liar. Forgiveness has the power to break those chains of bitterness. Forgiveness has the power to release the shackles of resentment. Forgiveness has the power to free oneself from the prison of past hurt. Stop living in the past, live in the present, and look forward to the future. It has the power to start a new chapter and to wipe the slate clean. Forgiveness has the power to stand in freedom that Christ has given you and has given me. Ephesians 4:32 says, be kind and helpful to one another, tender-hearted, compassionate, understanding, forgiving one another readily and freely, just as God in Christ has also forgiven you. Forgiveness has the power to set you free, but not only the forgiveness, the power of forgiveness. We need to understand the purpose of forgiveness. Secondly, let us look at the purpose of forgiveness. The purpose of forgiveness is not to absolve the offender of the consequences of their actions, nor is it to deny the wrong that has been done.
We understand that because when David messed up with Bathsheba, God forgave him, but he didn't remove the consequences because he still lost his son. Rather, the purpose of forgiveness is to align our hearts with God's will and foster healing and restoration in ourselves and in the person that needs to be forgiven. It is about letting go of the right to hold a grudge. But some of us think we have this privilege. Some of us think we have this right to hang on to grudges. But when we forgive, it gives us the right to let the grudge go and choosing to love in spite of pain. When we forgive, we mirror the heart of God. We mirror the heart of Jesus, who forgave us when we were yet sinners. Forgiveness is the bridge that connects broken past to a hopeful future. It is the doorway through which reconciliation can walk. We were reconciled when he went to that cross. We were reconciled when he hung his head and died. We were reconciled when he said all these things. We were reconciled. That is what forgiveness does. Colossians 3:13 says, bearing graciously with one another and willing forgiving each other. If has a cause for complaint against one another, just as the Lord has forgiven you, you should forgive. He didn't complain about us, so we need to stop complaining about each other. Instead of complaining, he forgave. We need to forgive instead of complaining. Not only do we have to understand the purpose of forgiveness, but we have to use the practice of forgiveness. My last point before I take my seat, we must consider the practice of forgiveness. Forgiveness is not a one-time event. It is daily. It is ongoing. The Bible says we are to forgive 7 times 7. That's a lot of times. We need to continue forgiving. We need to practice forgiving. Forgiving needs to become a habit, sometimes hourly, sometimes daily, sometimes minute by minute, sometimes second by second. It is easy to speak of forgiveness when we are the recipients of forgiveness and grace. But the true test comes when we are the ones that need to extend it to somebody else. Forgiveness must be practiced in our homes. Forgiveness must be practiced in our workplaces. Forgiveness must be practiced in our churches and even towards one another and even towards ourselves. It is an act of obedience to God's command, a testament to our faith and a witness to the world of the love and the mercy found in Christ Jesus. Matthew 6:14 and 15 says, for if you forgive others their trespasses, their reckless and willful sins, our heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, nurturing your hurt and anger with the result that interferes with your relationship with God, then your heavenly Father will not forgive you. And as I get ready to take my seat, my brothers and sisters, the question before us is not to forgive or not to forgive, but rather how will we choose to embody the forgiveness that Jesus Christ has so freely extended to you and extended to me? We must reflect on the monumental forgiveness that hung on that cross of Calvary. We must look past the nails in his hands, which look past the nails in his feet, which look past the crown of thorns on his head, which look past the scorn, the mockery, the cruelty, the humiliation, and the embarrassment, and saw the need for humanity's redemption. In other words, he looked beyond your faults, looked beyond my faults, and saw our need. Now I have to say this, that there may be somebody here today sitting under the sound of my voice who may be fighting, struggling, wrestling with the hurt that seems too deep to let go, too fresh, and transgressions that appear unforgivable. But I'm here to let someone know today that you have the power of God within you, because the Bible says greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world, and he will give you the power to be able to forgive. It's time to let go of the burden. It's time to let go of the hurt. It's time to let go of the pain, not because they deserve it, but because you deserve peace. You deserve to be free from the toxicity that unforgiveness breeds within your spirit. Remember this, forgiveness does not excuse the offense, but rather releases the offense into God's capable hands so that we can be set free. Forgiveness is the key to unlocking the fullness of God's blessings in your life. Forgiveness is the key to unlocking the fullness of God's love and grace in your life. It is the final act of love that says, despite it all, I choose the way of Jesus. So as we sit and stand here today in the shadow of Calvary's cross, let us commit to a life of forgiveness. Let us begin in this very room. Let us heal it in our families. Let it transform our communities, and let it change the world. For when we choose to forgive, we choose to live in the abundance. abundance of God's grace and God's mercy and God's love, and we open up the doors that others can do the same. May God keep you. May God heal you. May God help you to forgive as freely as He's forgiven. And may God bless you and keep you real good in Jesus' wonderful and holy name. Somebody give God praise. Somebody give God glory. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout, because He's worthy to be glorified, and He's worthy to be praised.
Hey. We're going to give support to Reverend Julie Moses, but how about that for Reverend Gerario? The power, the purpose, and prepare. Amen. We're going to sing Power, Power in the Blood. Can we sing that now before we get to our next? All right, come on, let's stand together and sing. Y'all going to be singing for a while. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood. Here we go.
There is power.
Singing for us now.
Jesus, I love you.
the second word by Reverend Maurice.
Good afternoon. Can you imagine that I am now following Reverend Smith? This morning I said to him that he'll be doing the lead-off backing. He says, yes, he'll be taking the first ball. But we give honor to the glory of God. Christ's second utterance from the cross marks the first glorious fulfillment of his prayer for his Father's forgiveness. And it shows how generously that forgiveness was bestowed, even on the most unlikely of recipients. As the hours of agony passed on the cross, one of the two thieves who had mocked Christ earlier now had a change of heart. What prompted the change is not mentioned. Perhaps the thief heard and was touched by Jesus' prayer for mercy, realizing that it applied to him who was a thief. Whatever prompted his turnaround, it was a tremendous miracle. The man was undoubtedly one of the most thoroughly degenerate people on the scene. He and his confidant were career criminals, men whose lives had been devoted to thievery and deception. And so, as he listened to Christ on the cross, asking for forgiveness for those who placed him there, he had this change of heart. They obviously knew of his innocence because the repentant thief finally rebuked his other cohort, saying, "This man has done nothing wrong." Luke 23:4. Yet, until one of them repented, they were both heaping ridicule and scorn on the Savior. But there came a point when one thief taunting turned to silence, and the silence turned to repentance, and the thief's heart was utterly changed. As he studied Jesus suffering all that abuse so patiently, never reviling or insulting his tormentors, the thief began to see that this man on in the center of and this cross has indeed who he claimed to be. The proof of his repentance is seen in his immediate change behavior as his insults turned to words of praise for Christ. For he rebuked his partner in crime. He said to him, "Do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed, justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man in the center of the cross has done nothing wrong." In saying that much, he confessed his own guilt. And he also acknowledged the justice of the penalty he had been given. So he affirmed the innocence of Christ as well. Then he turned to Jesus and confessed him as Lord. "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Amen. That confession of Jesus as Lord and King was immediately followed by the second of Jesus' seven last sayings. And Jesus said unto him, "Assuredly, I say unto you, today you will be with me in paradise." No sinner was ever given a more explicit assurance of salvation. This man, unlikely of saints, was received immediately and unconditionally into the Savior's kingdom. The incident is one of the greatest biblical illustrations of the truth of justification by faith. And all he said was, "Lord, have mercy upon me." And Christ said to him, "Today you will be with me in paradise." sometimes we see that there are those who go around and have all this talk and all kinds of things, but all you and I need to do is to ask God for forgiveness. We heard the first word from Reverend Smith when he says that Christ offered forgiveness. Christ still offers forgiveness to all of those who have done you wrong and what they have done to you. So this thief's request was final desperate end of his rope plea for a small mercy he knew he did not deserve. It echoes the plaintive cry of the publican who would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat on his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. For either man to be granted eternal life and receive into the kingdom, it had to be on the merits of another. And yet, in both cases, Jesus gave full and immediate assurance of complete forgiveness and eternal life. Those classic proofs that justification by faith alone is what Christ and what God reserved of us. Jesus' words to the dying thief convey to him an unqualified promise of full forgiveness. Covering every evil deed he had ever done, he wasn't expected to atone for his own sins, do penance, or perform any ritual. He wasn't consigned to purgatory, though if that really were such a place, and if the doctrines that involve me, that was all Christ said to him, but it was all the thief needed to hear. He was still suffering unspeakable physical torment, but the misery in his soul was now gone. For the first time in his life, he was free from the burden of his sins. The Savior at his side was bearing that sin for him, and the thief was now clothed in Christ's perfect righteousness. Soon they would be in paradise together. The thief had Christ's own word on that. Today, as you all come and we are listening to the messages and we listen to the singing, you too can be in paradise with Christ. All you need to do is to ask him to forgive you and to come into your heart, and he'll do that. Need no kind of fussing around, whatever. So as you listen to the word of God today from the speakers, I pray that you'll open your heart to receive him. Though if you have never experienced Christ before, today is the day that you could be in paradise with him. God bless.
Amen. We're singing glory to his name, precious name, glory to his name. Dear to my heart was the blood of life, singing glory to his name. We're singing glory to his name, precious name, we're singing. Music. Thank you.
There is a blood that cost a life, that paid my way. Death is pride. There is a grave that tried to hide this precious blood that gave me life. But in 3 days, he breathed again and rose to stand in my my life. I owe my all.
Amen. Nothing but the blood. Praise God. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. That was wonderful. Praise God. That was wonderful. Praise God. I am happy to have you all here today. I welcome Reverend Moses and the Peel Methodist Church as hosts of this service today, and we are blessed to have you, and we welcome all of you to this place. It's just a delight from year to year to have you come and fellowship with us. And this is a special weekend for me. I have my brothers and sisters with me here from Florida and from New York, and might I say my good-looking brothers and sisters. I want them to stand up and for you to see them this morning. I don't see Tyron. Is he? Where's Tyron? All right. I don't see where he's at. All right, he's back there. That's my sister Joan's husband. So he's a brother-in-law, but he's a brother. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. This coming Sunday is my birthday. It just happens that my birthday comes this time on Easter. That makes me extra special. So they decided to come in for Easter and at the same time come in for my birthday. I'm 73. I'm 73 and I feel great. I'd just like to also mention that I'm happy to see persons from the Light Community Wesleyan Church who worships here every Sunday afternoon in the congregation. We welcome you here as well today at the Lutheran Gathering. I think my time is going. So let it be, O Lord, that your word preached and proclaimed this day will profit every soul, bowing in your presence, and let the words of my mouth, the meditation of our hearts, be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. And the church said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Relationships are important. Relationships are important. As I sat there this morning, the first two words on the subject of forgiveness, and then the word I want to implant in your mind this morning is family. It's interesting that family is here in this text and that my family are here today. But I want to call this message Living for Others. Living for Others. And as you read this passage in John chapter 19 and verse 25 to 27, it reads, now they stood by the cross of Jesus, his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciples whom he loved standing by, he said to his mother, woman, behold thy son. Then said he to this disciple, behold thy mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her to his own home. Few thoughts, and I close. That relationships are important, and the women are important. It says that they stood by the cross, three outstanding women. Mary, the mother of Jesus, and we call her, Matthew calls her a Salome in other passages, and then Mary Magdalene. These individuals stood by the cross of Jesus. The disciples, with the exception of John, they had all deserted but the women were there. The women were there. And what would the church be without women? Some places have a problem with women pastors and women preachers. I don't have any problem with that. What would the church be without women? So we thank God that standing by the cross of Jesus, John tells us that there was Mary, his mother, Mary's sister, Salome, as well as Mary Magdalene. We know that he had cast devils out of her. And so I want to say that they were standing there at the cross as support for Jesus. But I like to think that they were there as well to support Mary. Simeon had said to Mary when he came for Jesus to be blessed by him, he said to her, "A sword shall pierce through thine own soul also." And doubtless this was being manifested as Jesus hung on the cross. A sword was piercing through Mary's heart. And right there beside her was her sister, as well as Mary, Magdalene. And I want to say that the text is giving us the message that we ought to be there for others. Be there for others in times of sadness, in times of grief, in times of sorrow. We should be there, even if we don't say anything. Just our presence means something. Living for others is what Jesus Christ did. He hung on the cross. He could have thought about himself, the agony, the pain, the suffering that he had already endured and was enduring. But rather than thinking of himself, he thought of others. He thought about his mother. And by extension, he was thinking of us, for he had said, "God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life." Greater love has no man than this, than one laid down his life for his friend. And I want to say that as Jesus thought not of himself, but of his mother, he is communicating to us that we should support our mothers. You must support your mother. You must not desert her. You must not find excuses for not supporting her. Jesus rebuked the Pharisees because they said, "You can say that it is Corban." And by that expression, they were saying, you could say that it is a gift. Tell your mother, if you don't want a supporter, that you have given the money to the synagogue, to the temple, to the church. And Jesus said, by so doing, you are putting your laws above God's law, for God has said in the fifth commandment, honor thy father and thy mother. And so I want you to leave here today with a consciousness that you are to support your mother. Amen. And finally, this morning, he saw John there, and as he said to Mary, "Behold your son. I can no longer fulfill the responsibility of a son to you any longer. But here is my beloved disciple." He made that last request of John. Take care. She is now your mother. And the text said that from that very day, John took her to his own home. I consider that a privilege. I consider it a responsibility. When Jesus asks something of us, we must be obedient. We must follow his will. And so let me conclude this morning by saying that life is best lived when it is not just live for self, but in the service of God and in the service of others. And so this word, this third word from the cross, which is probably the most of them all, the most simplest of them to preach upon, conveys a message that you and I need to hear, that family is important. Serving others is important. When we serve others, we are serving God. When we are serving the church, we're not serving the building as much as we're serving the people of the church, for the people of God are truly the church. So I trust that as the songs says this morning, and I close with that, it says, Lord, help me to live from day to day in such a self-forgetful way that even when I kneel to prayer, my prayer shall be for others. And I can't sing, but it says, others, Lord, yes, others. Better come to the last line. Help me to live for others, that I might live like thee. Others, Lord, yes, others, that I might live like thee.
Reverend Smith and Pastor Gibbs have put me to work this morning. I just came to sit in the congregation and with my wife and to enjoy the service, but here I am. So who want to go to the cross with me this morning? Huh? It's in the cross, in the cross. Come on, church. Be my glory ever. Till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Come on, church. One more time, George, come on. Church.
Praise him. Praise him. Let us continue to praise him. Hallelujah. We are coming to the fourth word. And this fourth word will be done by Reverend Dr. Wendell Gibbs. Where is he?
Good afternoon. It seems our pastor has forsaken us. I'm Minister Kevin Dill from First Baptist Church. Please allow me to help in his absence. The fourth word is Matthew 24:46. It says, my God, why have you forsaken me? My pastor. Why have you forsaken me? I have a crazy pastor. He seems to have forsaken us, folks. But, you know, I hope the point of this message is clear. We may be forsaken because of our self-sinfulness and rejection of God. But because of his grace, God has our own reckoning for forgiveness. And we forgive you, Pastor, if you show up now.
I'm here. I was lost, but now I'm found. Oh.
Praise God.
It was the sixth hour leading into the ninth hour, 3 hours later on the cross. It turned complete darkness. The man who was the light of the world was hanging on a cross in complete darkness. And then he declared, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? I really thought of going home and eating my fried fish and cuckoo. But we got to finish this message and I got 10 minutes. I wasn't gone for 5 minutes. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Have you ever felt that way with family and friends? It's okay if wife abandoned you. It's okay if family and friends abandoned you. But it's never okay if God abandons you. But Jesus is on that cross for a purpose. You see, this is a tough passage for us to understand. Because all along, Jesus was calling God Abba Father. Have you called him Abba Father lately? Because he is close to you. He was walking with the Son every step of the way. But now, the spawn of the questions is more than the answers. The biggest being, how could God abandon his Son in the moment of the greatest anguish of his life? However, I want to suggest to you, it was the opposite. It wasn't so much God abandoning his Son. It was his Son submitting himself and becoming like you and I so he can become the ultimate sacrificial Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. Somebody say amen. Amen. It is Christ willingly submitting to be the once and for all sacrificial Lamb for the sake of our salvation. You see, he would be turned into a bloody mess that God can turn it into a message. He'd be put to the test so that God can turn it into a testimony of the Old Testament. He was put on trial so that God can turn it into a triumph. And he would have been turned into a victim so he can prove that he is the victor, the conquering line of the tribe of Judah, conquering sin and death on our behalf. You see, this is the heart of the gospel message that Jesus was displaying in this moment when God seemed to turn his back on him. But what God was doing is turning his back on his carnal nature, his human nature. God was turning his back on each one of us as we forsake and sin against him and as we fall short in all the glory he's asking of us. But for Jesus. But for Jesus, who represents the grace we're talking about, that is able to bring reconciliation and restitution into our lives. The word tells me in Philippians chapters 2, verses 9, therefore God highly exalted him to the highest place in the midst of absenteeism and gave him the name that is above every name. Come on, somebody. The name that is above every name, that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess, in heaven and on, in First Baptist and in Cornerstone, in BME and in AME, hallelujah, in the Catholic, in the Presbyterian, in the Methodist, it don't matter. God says Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow. I can't wait when Trump bows before the throne of God, and God says, here I am the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I can't wait till Biden bows. I can't wait till Trudeau bows. I can't wait till all those rich Elon Musk and all the other musky ones that are around. I can't wait till they bow, because every knee shall bow. In the midst of his absence and forsakenness, God is declaring that it's for a purpose to bring my restoration back into my carnal people. Amen. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. It is Martin Luther in the 16th century through the Reformation. He once sat in his study for hours and meditated on this passage. And this is what he declared. God forsaking God. God forsaking God. You see, he was Abba Father before the cross. But in that absence, he was Theos. He was God. God the Supreme, above his nature. In his divinity, he was equal to God, Abba Father. But in his human nature, he was subject to the Theos, the God of creation. Hallelujah. So how can it be? For the first time in all of eternity, the Son of God knew the horror of being separated from his Father. No wonder that after the 6 long hours on the cross, and especially after those 3 long agonizing hours of separation from the Father, Jesus cried out in anguish, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Our sin is all in all its ugliness was laid on Jesus. He never called him Father. At this point, he called him God for all of us. Earlier in Gethsemane, he would have asked 3 times, Father, if it be possible, take this cup from me. But by his amazing grace, by his amazing submission, Jesus did something for us at Calvary that we were unable to do for ourselves. Hallelujah, somebody. He might have been forsaken that we might be forgiven. He might have been abandoned that we might be adopted. He might have been deserted that we might be delivered. He might have been separated so we can have intimacy with God. He might have died, but because we can live. And he lives, as you know, forevermore, not just on this life, but he lives eternally. And he made a promise, as I go to you right now, he made a promise, I am going to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. Amen? Stay faithful. Jesus is coming back.
We're together again, just praising the Lord. We're together again, on one accord. Something good is about to happen. Something good is in store. We're together again, just praising the Lord.
Let us pray. Oh Lord, we thank you. Lord, we bless your holy name. Lord, as you have promised, you give us strength, O Heavenly Father. Lord, you fill us with measure, O God, that we receive every day. Lord, you have given us the birth, O God, that bought flesh. But you has also given us a spirit, Lord, that bought spirit. So, Lord, we come today with the strength that you have given us, O God. You have given us the dew, and you have given us rain. Lord, you have given us the crops that bring blessing in our life. So, Lord, as you yield your increase, O God, we come to you, O God, today. And we bring what part of what, Lord, you have blessed us with, Lord. We ask, O Heavenly Father, that you will strengthen us, O God, that we can come boldly before you, O God, and offer our gift to you, O God. So we come knowing, O God, that all things that you have given to us, O God. So we bring, Lord, back to you portion of what you have blessed us with, O God. So, Lord, help us as individuals that we may use the gift that you have given us. So, Lord, we ask that you will give us the strength so we will accept it, O God, in the way that it was given to us, O God. So, Lord, we come knowing that all things that you have blessed us with, Lord, our gifts, our talents, and the voices, Lord, that we hear today, Lord, we want to say thank you, and we ask your blessing, O God, in the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and we all say amen and amen. All things, we'll sing together, all things come to thee, most Lord of thine. All things come to thee, O Lord of thine own, we give it thee. Sing, sing again, we'll sing. As we picked up the offering, can we sing again? Sing again.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Sin has left no. Are we still collecting offering? Yes, we are still collecting offering. Amen, amen. As we continue to collect offering, we want to welcome East York Scarborough BME Church, who will be our next music selection. Amen. Come on, put your hands together, give God praise. Give God praise as we receive them. Amen. Amen. The offering has already been blessed. Amen.
Sweet. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everyone. We give God praise and thanks, and the special thanks go to the East York Saints, they only half the size of the last year. Praise God. Give them a hand, please. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm with you again this year. And it's a pleasure as always. And today, as I did before, I just want to have a heart-to-heart talk with you. And just bow your heads, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for this important, oh God, opportunity that you have given me again, oh God, to expound your word to your people. I ask, oh God, that your Holy Spirit will speak to me. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Well, my text today is John 19, verse 28. It says, I thirst. But there are two things about this text. One is, of course, that Jesus was thirsty. And the other part of that verse said that this was a fulfillment of prophecy. It was a fulfillment of prophecy. And that suggests to me, ladies and gentlemen, that Jesus did not have to say he was thirsty. But in obedience to his Father's mandate that he gave him, he was making sure that the prophecies of the Old Testament was fulfilled and recorded. He was God and is God. He's sovereign. He knew exactly that they were going to give him a cheap wine, vinegar wine. He had control over the time of his death. The Bible says that Jesus said, no man takes my life away from me. I give it. And so if he was overcome by a thirst that was so overwhelming, he could have ended his life even there. But he did it so that the scripture might be fulfilled. Amen. So what can the church today, the contemporary church, take from the words of Jesus when he says, I thirst? Well, very often in the Bible, the words that are used literally must be considered to be symbolic. What does that mean? When it's interpreted and applied to believers like you and me, it must take on a spiritual context. Jesus said, I was thirst, and that was physical. He had been scourged. He had been beaten. And historians tell you that the beating was so terrible that some of his flesh was hanging down. It was painful, it was anguish, it was agony. And so he really had a need for something to slake his thirst. But we don't need to slake our thirst or to quench our thirst in this manner, because Jesus has already done it for us. Amen. Praise the Lord. So what is needed, I believe, is that there must be a spiritual parallel for those words. Jesus said, I thirst. How can we apply that to the church today? I believe that God wants us to be thirsty, but not for alcohol, not for drugs, not even for water. I didn't need to have any resources here to tell you what to be thirsty meant, because we know that from the early ages of our lives, that when we are thirsty, we have to quench that thirst. But I believe that Jesus wants us to thirst after righteousness. Amen. To pursue righteousness, to pursue it with a spiritual vigor and conviction. And so it begs the question then, what does it mean to be thirsty? What does it mean to be thirsty? Well, simply put, to be thirsty means to have a craving. I've been around pregnant women for a long time. Amen. And sometimes the things that they crave, they don't eat it when they're not pregnant. They don't need it. But it's a thirst that has to be quenched. So to be thirsty means to have a craving for something, to have an excessive desire for something, an overwhelming desire that has to be satisfied. Amen. A person who thirsts for alcohol all of the time is an alcoholic. One who thirsts for drugs on a continuous basis is called a what? A drug addict. And you can, in your mind, you can think of others, other things that people thirst for, and you can give them the names. I wouldn't give it to you now. But there is a desire, and if it's continuous, it becomes an addiction. And as I stand here and talk to you, the Spirit is telling me to say, I wish, I would to God, that we believers would have an addiction to righteousness. Amen. I would to God that we would have an addiction to righteousness so that we can crave it. And we can have that exorbitant desire, that excessive desire to obtain that righteousness that God wants us to have. Amen? Yeah, listen to the doctor. He's always right. If he says it's good, it's good. Praise God. You know, the psalmist understood what it was to be thirsty. In Psalm 42, he expresses that desire by saying, as the heart pants after the water brook, so pants my soul after you, O God. Amen. My soul thirsted for God, for the living God. Again, I would that Christians would have the thirst so that they can pursue the righteousness that God wants us to have. And you say, well, Pastor, I know a little bit about the Bible. And the Bible says in Romans that if you accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, that God the Father declares you, said that you are justified and declares you righteous. So why are you telling me to pursue righteousness? Well, the key word there is pursue righteousness, because the righteousness that you received was a righteousness that led to salvation. You have been declared worthy of being saved. Jesus has reconciled you, and by accepting that gift of salvation, God no longer turns his back on you. You can now stay in the presence of holiness. You have become a child of God. The problem is that so many of us remain children. We don't want to get out of the, how can I put this, out of the basement of the spiritual basement of God our Father. So we have been declared righteous. And we stay there and we say, praise the Lord, hallelujah. Glory be to God. And we dance, and I used to dance when I was young, so I know what I'm saying to you. And we dance and praise God, hallelujah, hallelujah. And that is good, because God inhabits the praises of his people. But he wants more than that. There was only one thief on the cross who had no time to work in the vineyard of God. God wants you to shake off the dust and get out of the basement and become a worker in his vineyard. You pursue righteousness
by taking actions, their souls to be saved. There are people who are in need. God saved you to continue the work that the disciples in the book of Acts did. The first century Christians, they continued the work. Luke said, I am writing this book so that you can know what Jesus did and said and taught. And we are to continue that same thing. Amen. It is time that we not only become children of God, we are saved. That's not good enough. We are to become servants of God. We are to work in his vineyard. Amen. We are to go out there and meet the needs of those who are less fortunate than we are. And then as we climb that ladder of sanctification, we seek to become consecrated to the point where we can say, as Paul said, I don't care. I will go to Jerusalem. I don't care if I'm imprisoned or bound. I don't care if I die. So it seems to me that there are three stages in this whole concept of righteousness. Number one, the righteousness that you are declared to be when you accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. You're a child. If you die, you're going to heaven. But there will be no star to your crown. There will be no reward. Because Jesus told his disciples, stay here until you're imbued with power from on high. Stay in Jerusalem and then go out and win souls in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and then to the uttermost parts of the world. That's what we are saved to do. It is time not only to work in the vineyard, it is time to don or to put on the whole armor of God, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, and the sword of the Spirit. God wants us to fight against the evil that is this world. It is time to engage in spiritual warfare. Hallelujah. It is time to become soldiers of the cross. Get out of the basement of God's spiritual basement and become a soldier in the army of God. May God bless you.
Oh, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart thrown away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy. Oh, come on, church, come on, church, at the cross. Come on, church, where I first saw the light, when the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight.
Good afternoon, everyone. Nice to see your beautiful faces on this good Friday morning. Sorry, good afternoon. Friday afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, from to the fiercest drought and storm.
Praise the Lord. In Christ alone. Let the church say, it is finished. It is finished. It is finished. Praise the Lord. I'll get back to this a little later. In Christ alone. Praise the Lord. Well, it's a blessing to be in the house of God. I'm going to get a little closer if you don't mind. We've learned many things this morning from our dear doctors and pastors and reverends. We've learned about the power of forgiveness. We've learned that we will one day be with God in paradise. We've learned the familial responsibility we have to our mothers. We've learned that Jesus is coming back. We've learned that we should have an addiction to righteousness. We've learned that our beloved pastor is about to be 73 years old. And we've learned that he really can't sing. But we love him. We love him anyway. Which brings us to this sixth word. It is finished. Taken from the book of John, chapter 19, 28 to 30. It says, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. A vessel was full of sour wine, and it was sitting there. And so they filled it with a sponge. So they filled the sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. Bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. It is finished. We've heard these words time and time again. But what do they mean? What is finished? What exactly is Jesus talking about? As I researched for today's sermon, I realized that Jesus was talking about the cost of our salvation. The cost of our salvation. What is the cost of our salvation? We know that in our daily lives, we have many things that are expensive. I did my research. It says that a car costs approximately $66,000. A new car costs about $66,000 in today's day and age. If you want to go to school to earn your diploma program, you're probably going to pay an average of $2,400. If you want to get your BA, it's about $6,100 a year. There's a cost to everything. If you want to have a decent marriage, a decent wedding ceremony for 150 guests, it costs about $35,000 to $40,000. It can cost more, depending on taste, but that's the average cost. If you want to get divorced, it can cost up to double that, upwards of $80,000. So remember, you can save some money by staying married, as miserable as you are. Put some money back in your pocket and stay married. And of course, we know the cost of housing. Whew. Here in the GTA, the average cost of the house, the average cost is just over $1.1 million. Ouch. Stuff is expensive, but nevertheless, we have to get it. It's something that we need. Our salvation is no different. It's expensive, but we need it. Our salvation is something we need. We cannot afford to be without. And all of us need it. Scripture says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It says that the wages of sin is death. The price for our sin is death. The price for our sin is eternal damnation, darkness, suffering, sin, shame, guilt. That is the price that we have, that is the debt that we have incurred upon ourselves by being sinful creatures. In Genesis, Adam and Eve were told specific instructions on how they might be righteous, how they might stay in good standing with God. We know how that story turned out. They disobeyed God. They ate the forbidden fruit. Not so much that they ate the fruit, but that they disobeyed the instructions of the Almighty God. And because of this, sin and darkness entered the world. But that wasn't the end of it. Civilization after civilization kept on incurring more debt, more of this sin debt. Sin had a hold on all of us. Paul says that as time goes on, we invent new ways to sin. Indeed, we lie, cheat, steal, murder, all sorts of evil. Instead of obeying God, we obeyed the devil. And we deserve the same punishment that the devil's going to get. We deserved destruction. We deserved condemnation. We deserved eternal damnation. Church, we need salvation. We needed salvation. But we couldn't afford it. Salvation was something that we just could not pay. It was more expensive than a nice wedding. It was more expensive than a nice house. The cost of that salvation was a living, breathing sacrifice. We remember the account of Moses and the people of Israel in Exodus, how God was sending plagues upon the Egyptians. And finally, it came down to a plague of the death of the firstborn son. We're going to go back to the Old Testament. We remember that the angel of death was going to come down and it was going to go over the land, and anybody's firstborn son was going to die, except God gave the Israelites instruction. He told them to find a lamb without spot. a lamb without blemish. Slaughter the lamb. Take the blood from that lamb and spread it over the doorpost. And when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. That lamb, that innocent animal, was an atonement for them. It was their salvation. Later on in Leviticus, we see God again giving the instructions to the people of Israel. When the people will sin, when the priest will sin, you shall get a bull without defect, and you shall go before the temple, and you shall slaughter it, and that will be a sin offering unto the Lord. That poor bull. But innocent as that animal was, it had to die to be an atonement for the people of Israel and for their sins. And so they slaughtered animals. And this was good for a time, but, you know, being human beings, we sin again and again and again. The slaughtering of animals just wasn't enough. The price for our eternal salvation was greater than those innocent animals. It was greater than anything we could possibly pay. The price and the cost for our salvation was the life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus is the only one who could pay the price. Christ alone. Thank you, Sister Agnes. And so after all of the suffering and the beatings and the whippings and dragging the cross through the street and the crown of thorns and the mocking and the nails in his hands and his feet, and finally he's hanging there on the cross, we reach this junction and we ask ourselves some questions. Has the price been paid? Has the cost for our salvation been paid? Are we still under this grip of sin, this debt of sin? Will we ever be free? Does sin still have a hold on us? Jesus doesn't leave any questions unanswered. He says, look to the cross. It is finished. It is finished. It is paid in full. Death has been defeated. Sin has been defeated. The head of the serpent has been crushed. I got some laundry to do tonight, but that's okay. I want to illustrate this point to you. Victory has been won. We don't have to be depressed anymore. We don't have to be guilty anymore. We can look to the cross. We can look to the cross and live, church. Can I get an amen? Amen. It is finished. It is finished. Jesus says it's been paid for. It's all good. You're not in debt anymore. You're not a slave to sin anymore. You're not cursed anymore. You're blessed. You're not poor anymore. You're rich. You're not the tail anymore. You're the head. Because I have set you free. And whom the Son has set free is free indeed. Glory, hallelujah. We are free. We are free today, church. We are free because Jesus has paid it all. Tetelestai, as the Greeks would say. Not just that the debt has been paid now, that we'll sin again and we'll have to come to the altar again and slay another animal. No, tetelestai is that the debt has been paid now and indefinitely it has been paid. In perpetuity, perpetually it has been paid. Eternal life is ours and ours for the taking because of the cross. Look at the cross and live. Look at the cross and live. Just as Moses lifted up that serpent, remember that account, lifted up that serpent and all those people who were dying and from sickness of being bit by serpents, they were dying, but all they had to do was look to the cross, look to the serpent and live back then. We can look to the cross and live. The Son of Man has been lifted up. Look to the cross and live. Jesus paid it all. That everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. There must be a catch, you'd say. Who would come along and pay such a great debt for us? Bail us out of eternal damnation. There must be a catch. There is. There's something that we have to do. We must believe. We must believe. Scripture says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Church, we must believe. Amen. I'm wrapping up. And so it doesn't matter who you are, whether you're rich or poor, black or white, whether you sinned a little bit, sinned a lot, salvation is there for you. You get salvation. You get salvation. You get salvation. We all get salvation because Jesus paid the price for us all. He paid the price for me. He paid the price for you. Look to the cross and live, brother. Look to the cross and live, sister. Doesn't matter what kind of life you've lived. Look to the cross and live. Jesus has paid it all. Tetelestai, the debt has been paid. Glory to God and amen. Amen.
Amen.
Glory to his name. Amen. Glory to his holy name. Thank you, Lord. You are worthy.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I surrender all. Come on, church. Sister Crystal Cook. Amen. Come on, church. Yeah, welcome her. Amen.
Took the blame.
Amen. Bringing the last word, our gracious hostess on this day. Put your hands together. Give God praise. Give God glory for this massive, powerful woman of God who is about to give a word of God to edify his people and glorify him. Put your hands together and bless God for the Reverend Julia Moses.
Jesus cried on the cross. And these words are, Father, into your hand I commend my spirit. Remember, he was dying. So he said, Father, I commend my spirit in your hand. But I ain't come here to tell you that today. We live in. Thank him for life. So today I come to tell you to put everything in God's hand. Amen. You have some things that you're holding on to. Let them go. Amen. I was sitting there. He tell me, tell them, let them go. Because those things you're holding on to is causing contention in the churches. So what you don't understand, give it to God. Don't criticize the pastors. Encourage the pastors. Amen? Because in today's life, we see what is taking place. We see how many pastors are falling. So I come to tell you the pastors need prayer. Pray them up. Don't pray them down. I thank God for my congregation. You all listen to Crystal? In my church, obedient and respect. I deserve it. So they give it to me. Hallelujah. So Crystal, I thank you. I thank all the pastors who minister today. It's not easy, you know. You all sit down there and you all listen, but we who speak have to be guided by the Holy Spirit. If we don't, we messed up. So anytime you pastors standing on the pulpit, remember, let the Holy Spirit speak to you. Sunday after Sunday, you go to church. And Sunday after Sunday, God give you a word for your congregation. And if he don't give you, he give the person who is speaking. So I'm happy when I can sit down sometime and listen to the speakers in Peel. I have a lot of them, you know. And they're brave. And they love to speak about God. I'm very serious about that. Peel, raise your hand. Everybody in Peel, raise your hand. Raise your hand high. Raise your hand high. Where Brother Moses? I see his hand. Oh, I saw him over there. So, we have to realize that we have to put everything in God has. You know, he just dropped this in my spirit. And I'm not boasting. It's good when you're serving God. But it's better when you and your husband serving God. It make it much easier. I might say this, these things with tears in my eyes. But I admire how my husband served God. He ready on mornings for prayer and Bible study with his group. He ready on Wednesday night when we have him Bible teaching. And sometimes he come up with some things and I say, but God, that is truth. So Brother Moses, I thank God for you. Not many husband or wife can stand up here and thank God for their husband. Because they're going one way and the husband going another. But I thank God for you. And you might ask, what Reverend Moses is going to tell us? Because they say everything. I come to tell you, what I want to tell you is leave those things you're trying to control in God's hands. And let the church grow. Amen. 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 Let us humble ourselves to God. And when something going wrong, don't get angry and walk out. Call your pastor and say, I want to have a word with you. And don't do it in anger. Do it in love. Because when you do it in anger, you mess up everything. Amen? Amen. Am I right, Peter? Yes. So I thank you all today for coming. And I just want you all, as I say, to leave everything in God's hands. Don't try to do them on your own. You see how many pastors failing? Because they're trying to do everything on their own. And it has some pastors who think they're so high, so they can't meet the congregation. Amen? As I will never forget my daughter say, my mother, mix with the sheep till she smells like the sheep. My daughter say, I mix with the sheep till I smell like the sheep. Amen? Amen. Some pastors are too high. They feel they're so much above. I am the pastor. You ever hear some of them use that word? Listen to me, I am the pastor. But I come to tell you, he is the God. So when you feel you is the pastor, you still have a shepherd above you. A shepherd to guide. A shepherd to lead. Lead us in all directions. Reverend Javaro, where is he? I wasn't looking. I'm so proud of you. And you know I tell you that all the time. And I mean it. And I like your humility. Especially when you're talking to me. Reverend Hicks, my teacher. You know, that's what I call you all the time. I thank you for the second word. And I thank Reverend Patrick, for the third word. And in case you don't know, he belongs to Cornerstone Baptist Tabernacle. And the fourth word is my partner. What do you think is my partner? Look, 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 look on the program. We do a lot of things together. I'm very serious, you know. Reverend Wendell and I come along, we tell you all this all the time. A long way. And I remember a night I wasn't feeling well. And they had done my name on the program, and he was just pacing the place up and down, up and down. And when he saw me, he said, girl, thank God you come. So I thank God for you, Dr. Gibbs. Reverend Martin, I thank God for you. I always like to listen when you speak. East York should be happy to have a pastor like you. And young pastor, Jonathan Reed. Oh, give him a clap, give him a clap. Encourage him, encourage him, encourage him. Yes, a lot. So I thank God for each and every one today. And as I tell you, those things that you're struggling with, those things that you're fighting to carry, those things that you have sleepless night trying to figure out how to solve them, what I tell you to do? And when you put them there, leave them there. Amen? Amen. I thank all of you for coming. I love you all dearly. Thank you, Jesus. So we are going to close. I want the pastors to stand. I want all the pastors to stand. I don't think you all could see all of them. I want them to come down here. I want you all to look at these things.
Glory, praise the Lord.
I am going to hand over to my general superintendent. one who I love and adore. One who you can communicate with. One who listens when you speak and help when you need him. God bless you, Dr. Smith.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. The Lord is in the house today. I see people clapping. I hear people shouting. And that's good. Because today I'm going to tell you, we're walking billboards. Yes, we're walking billboards. 2 Corinthians 5, 16 to 21 tells us we are ambassadors. My brothers and sisters, that means something. Because you have to take the word as you got it. But then, among us, we could have a lot of diplomats too, who always dance with the situation. So today, I'm here to tell you, my Christian brothers and sisters, we are ambassadors for Christ. Just as God sent Christ to reconcile us to himself, and that was verse 18, to reconcile us to himself, we now have the ministry of reconciliation. And you'd see that in verse 19. Because I'll tell you this, good news kept silent is no news at all. It's time for us to go out there and make a difference. I'll tell you something, my brothers and sisters. The scripture tells us that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. So we need each and everyone to be part of this ministry. We need everyone. So my brothers and sisters, this is the time. Search your hearts. Are you sure you are connected and reconciled with God? And the acts that I do this portion that they refer to as invitation to Christian ministry. And I believe that there's something burning in each and everyone's heart today. That if I call you to come forward to say, come here and stand, and I'm sure the pastors will be happy to pray with you. Reconnect you. This is something you could be recommitting yourself, or you could be saying, Lord, send me. And I add that for one reason. It's a fear sometimes. When you're called for Christian fellowship and someone chooses to come up, the others look at him or her and say, oh my God, she's been in the church all this time. I thought she found God already. My brothers and sisters, we can come together and pray together. Corporate prayer is good. So at this time, I'm going to ask you to come forward. Those of you who want to pray with us at the end of this service. This is the day. Let us forget Gethsemane. Lest I forget thine agony. Lest I forget thy love for thee. Lead me to Calvary.
Yes, yes, yes. Lead me to Calvary.
Lest I forget Gethsemane.
So if anyone has a need for prayer,
I forget
come forward now.
Thine
come forward
now.
honor for guests here to it with us today, we'd just like to sing a few verses of a special song that means so much to her.
All the way to Calvary he went for me. He went for me.
He went for me.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Everybody stand up at this time, please.
Amen.
Stand if you're able, please. Oh, gracious Father, we thank you for this moment, Lord. We thank you that you were able to bring us together in this arrangement, Lord. Lord, time is important to each and every one. But Lord God, these individuals who have a heart for you,
yes, Lord,
made it their business to come and fellowship and worship with us. Although, Lord, I know that it's a moment when most individuals look at it as a time of sorrow and pain. But Lord, that cross, that has brought salvation to each and every one of us. For that we are grateful, Lord. We are very thankful. Lord God, for these individuals who made it to the front.
Amen.
Who felt that need to touch you one more time. Lord, let them feel your spirit working in them right now, Lord. Because they need you every hour, every minute, and every day, Lord. They need you. Lord, if there's anything in them that is not of you, any situation, Lord, remove it right now.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, I ask that you forgive each and every one of them right now for sins known or unknown, Lord. Because, Lord, this is a challenging world, and at their times they don't even know when the sin is a sin. But Lord, you know. So Lord, we ask that you give them that peace that surpasses all understanding. And Lord, if it's for healing they need right now, Lord, anoint them right now with the crown of their heads right now, Lord. Anoint them, Lord. And let your healing spirit go through them to the soles of their feet right now, Lord. So that they will know that you are the God that they serve. And as of today, Lord, they will have a testimony of your greatness. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God be with you all. God be with you. God bless you. Lord, take you and give you the peace that you need. Amen and amen.
Amen. These are the ones with courage that step forward by faith.
But I'm sure there's many more of you that are sitting there that's probably saying, you know what? I can raise my hands or step forward and only God can see it. And I think we understand that in the modern day context that it's much more of God working in your heart right where you are. Sitting in the pews at home, in the subway somewhere, God can transform you without coming to an altar. Are you agreeing with me right now? So I'm speaking to somebody else online, somebody listening on live stream, somebody sitting in the pew who's afraid to step forward. But God is speaking to your heart right now. And what we say at our church is you raise your hands real high so God can see it. We don't have to see it. But in your heart, you can raise your hands so high that when God sees it, he can transform you. You know why? Because the first word says forgive. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. So today, we declare in the first word, God forgive you. And then the second word that goes to step forward right now, the second word says what? Today thou shalt be with me in paradise. You are sitting already in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Somebody say amen. So even though you may not be standing at the altar, you give your heart to Christ even right now, and you are sitting already in heavenly places, Christ Jesus. And then the third word says what? Behold, my children, my sons and my daughters. Behold the ones who have adopted into the family of God. Isn't that awesome? That's the third word where God is saying we belong together. And the fourth word says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? God forsake Jesus so he can stay close to you. Jesus gave himself up so God can be your Father, Abba, Father. Hallelujah. And the fifth word, we want to say thanks again for the fifth word. The fifth word declares, it says right here, it says, I thirst. I'm looking for a long sentence. That's why I can't say I thirst. And they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, they shall be filled. And thank God for the sixth word. When all is said and done, God declares it is finished. I have given you all that you need. And the word was what? The word was what? The word was, remember the word? Addiction to righteousness. That was a powerful word. And then it is finished. We were encouraged with that word, right? That is the cost of salvation. Thank you, brother, because Jesus paid it all. And then finally we find out, put everything into God's hands. Let's give a hand to all these wonderful pastors and leaders that express the word. And thank you also for being here today. We want to say thanks for joining us one more time on this Good Friday. We want to wrap it up soon because we've got some good fried fish waiting at home. Somebody say hallelujah. Amen. We've served our time and God is pleased today. And thank you for all the choirs and all those who participate. Pastor Reed, you come quickly. I think you have... Sorry? Yes, go ahead. Go right ahead. Go right ahead. Pastor Reed's got an announcement to make. Thank our host church and Pastor Reed.
Yes, thank you so very much. I asked Reverend Moses with her permission and Reverend Searles to add a few things there this morning. Just two things I want to say. Maybe I should give you the first one. The first one is that Jesus said that you shouldn't send them away empty. Give them something to eat lest they faint in the way. So downstairs following the service, there's some refreshments provided for you by Joan and Gloria and all the folks across here. So we don't like you to come to Cornerstone and faint in the way when you're going home. So go down, come downstairs and join us. And the second thing I'd like you to do for us, back in on October 31st on Halloween day, to believe it or not, we got a notice from the Toronto Parking Authority that they were going to close this parking lot that you have parked in for years. And so we have a petition going. It says save our parking lot and preserve our community. It's not for us. It's not just for Cornerstone Church. It's not going to be a private parking lot. It is a parking lot that serves the community. And it's been there for over 100 years, almost 100 years, served this church when it was St. Mark's and Calvary Anglican Church from 1930. And we believe it should be there for as long until Jesus comes as a parking lot rather than just a park. So there's a petition online that we'd like you to sign it online for those of you who are very techno-savvy. And for those of you who may not be so techno-savvy, this is a copy of the petition that I think we sent it out to some of your churches. And there's some at the back. If you would just sign this petition and put your signature on it and your telephone number so that they know it's not a bogus situation where we're just getting signatures, because we really do want to preserve that parking lot, not just in the present, but for the future. Are you hearing me? All right, so I trust that you'll do so. May God richly bless you. This has been a wonderful, wonderful service. We thank God for all that he's done today, and we give him the praise, the honor, and the glory for all that has been accomplished and all that shall be accomplished in future years to come.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
Amen. Happy birthday again, sir. Let's give him a hand. Thank you so much, Pastor Reed. And our host is going to come as we sing our last song, our traditional last song, And Can It Be? Look, it doesn't matter what you're going through. You were standing at the altar, sitting in the pews, or wherever you are online. It doesn't matter what you're going through in life. Struggles in life, families, economic struggles, work struggles, friend struggles, all the factors that a healed body is aching everywhere, you know, the belly, the back, the brain, and the backside. I call it the four B's as you get older. The four B's, the belly, the back, the brain, and the backside. You all know I'm talking about, you old people? Doesn't matter what you're going through, make sure that when you're hanging on by a thread, make sure it's the hem of his garment. Come on, somebody say amen. You can hang on forever on the thread of his garment because it's the hem of Jesus' garment. Amen. Let's stand and sing together. We're going to do a recessional, and we're going to sing And Can It Be? Reverend Moses, thank you again for hosting today. Julia Moses, come as we lead our last song. And Can It Be?
Of love divine, this mercy.
asking the Lord to continue to bless and keep you and let his light shine upon you. And he will give you peace throughout your life. Church, go in peace, and may the peace of God be with you. God bless.
Cry out, Jesus. In our desperation, in our longing, we lift our eyes to the heavens. The Savior that was promised reached down to us, becoming flesh. At his entrance, they laid palms at his feet, as today, in his presence, we fall to our knees. We cry out to him hanging on the cross, the righteous one whose blood broke the curse. An act of love that saved our souls, overflowing redemption, making us whole. No nail to the bones could hold him. No crown of thorns could shame him, because he is the one. No tomb could contain him. Death could not stop him. He conquered the grave and rose from death victorious. We cry out, Jesus, 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 you are the resurrection and the life. In you all things come alive. We will forever declare the mighty power of your name. We cry out with everything we have. We need you, Savior, and nothing else, because in you we are saved by grace. Your glory will shine upon the world, and every tongue will cry out, Jesus is the Lord. Thank you.
It's Friday. Jesus is praying. Peter's asleep. Judas is betraying. But Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Pilate's struggling. The council is conspiring. The crowd is vilifying. They don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary's crying. Peter is denying. But they don't know that Sundays are coming. It's Friday. The Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in scarlet. They crown him with thorns. But they don't know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary. His blood dripping. His body stumbling. And his spirit's burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The world's winning. People are sinning. And evil's grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nailed my Savior's hands to the cross. They nailed my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raised him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't know it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. He's hanging on the cross, feeling forsaken by his Father, left alone and dying. Can nobody save him? Oh, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, the earth trembles, the sky grows dark, my king yields his spirit. It's Friday, hope is lost, death has won, sin has conquered, and Satan's just a laugh. It's Friday. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard, and a rock is rolled into place. But it's Friday. It is only Friday. Sunday is a coming. Thank you.
we cry out, Jesus. In our desperation, in our longing, we lift our eyes to the heavens. The Savior that was promised reached down to us, becoming flesh. At his entrance, they laid palms at his feet, as today, in his presence, we fall to our knees. We cry out to him hanging on the cross, the righteous one whose blood broke the curse. With an act of love that saved our souls, overflowing redemption making us whole. No nail to the bones could hold him. No crown of thorns could shame him, because he is the one. No tomb could contain him. Death could not stop him. He conquered the grave and rose from death victorious. We cry out, Jesus, 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 you are the resurrection and the life. In you all things come alive. We will forever declare the mighty power of your name. We cry out with everything we have. We need you, Savior, and nothing else, because in you we are saved by grace. Your glory will shine upon the world, and every tongue will cry out, Jesus is the Lord.